Today, we will have a discussion on reptilia. Before going to reptilia, we have to see in what position is reptilia lying in the phylum Chordata. So here, you know, Chordata is an independent phylum. It is divided into three subphyla, Cephalochordata, Urochordata and Vertebrata. There are some basic chordate characters of which the first one is the presence of a notochord. So we will just view all these three subphyla with respect to the notochord. Cephalochordata is a subphylum of Chordata in which the organisms possess notochord from their head to the tail region. So the notochord will be seen extending from the head to the tail region, and that will be present throughout their life. So such chordates are called as cephalochordates. Now coming to the second category, that is urochordates. They too possess notochord, but the notochord is present only in the tail region. That is why the name urochordata. And the second thing is that the notochord which is present in the tail region is seen only in the larval stages. In the adult, you cannot see the tail or the notochord inside. So, for an organism to be called as a chordate, the notochord is to be present only at any stage of life cycle. This we can see from the example of urochordates. So, they possess notochord only in the larval tail. Now, coming to the third category, that is vertebrata. Vertebrates too possess notochord. But, in the adult stage, this notochord will be replaced by the vertebral column. In some organisms, the notochord will be persistent. In some vertebrates, the notochord will be persistent throughout life and a vertebral column develops around it. But in some vertebrates, the notochord will disappear in the adult and it will be completely replaced by the vertebral column. So here, the notochord is either wholly or partly replaced by the vertebral column. So, this is how we classify phylum Chordata into the three subphyla, Cephalochordata, Urochordata and Vertebrata. Now, coming to Vertebrata. This Vertebrata has got two divisions. They are Agnatha and Gnathostomata. So, we will just examine the word Gnath. Gnath means jaw. So, Agnatha means they are vertebrates which are lacking jaws. They do not have jaws. So they are called agnatha. Now, gnathostomata. Stome means mouth. So these vertebrates will be having jaws bordering their mouth. They are called gnathostomes. So these are jawless vertebrates and these are jawed vertebrates. So that is how we divide subphylum vertebrata into two divisions, agnatha and gnathostomata. Now, this gnathostomata, it is divided into two subclasses, two superclasses. They are Pisces and Tetrapoda. Pisces means those jawed vertebrates which move about with the help of fins. Tetrapods are those jawed vertebrates which move about with the help of four limbs. That is why the name Tetrapoda. Now, coming to Tetrapoda. In Tetrapoda, there are four classes. They are Amphibia, Reptilia, Aves and Mammalia. Reptiles are the crawling tetrapods. So, we will come to more reptilian characteristics. So, Reptilia belong to phylum Chordata, subphylum Vertebrata, division Gnathostomata, superclass Tetrapoda and they are it holds the status of a class. There are almost 6,000 species of reptiles which are so far identified. We will go to a quick look of their general characteristics. The first thing is that they are cold-blooded or poikilothermic or ectothermic. What does this mean? These organisms cannot maintain normal constant body temperature. According to the temperature changes in their surroundings, their body temperature also changes. So, they are dependent upon the external environment for their body temperature regulation. That is why they are said to be ectothermic or cold-blooded or poikilothermic. That means The body temperature changes according to the temperature of the surroundings. Now the next one. So, the reptilia is the first class invertebrata which have evolved or which have started a completely terrestrial life. Up to the other classes like amphibia or pisces, you can see that they have to depend upon water. Some are purely aquatic. You take the case of amphibians. Amphibians can be terrestrial, but for their fertilization and development they require a water body. But the reptiles are the first organisms to attempt a completely terrestrial life without any need of water to complete their life cycle. So since this terrestrial mode of life has been supported by one feature, that is they are lung breathing. They resort to pulmonary respiration. So they can breathe with the help of lungs, and they use lung as the only respiratory organ compared to the other aquatic organisms who use gills or skins or skin. Then they are oviparous, or they are egg laying forms. One of the major features is that they possess scales over their body, and these scales are epidermal. Sometimes these scales may be in the form of plates or spines on the skin. However, they are all epidermal in origin. Why I stressed this point? Because in fishes also you will study about scales. There, in fishes, the scales originate from the dermis layer of the skin. But here, the scales originate from the epidermal layer of the skin. Now, the reptiles have got two pairs of limbs which are pentadactyle. Penda means five, dactyle means digit. So they are built on a five digit plan. And these digits, they end in claws. Now coming to the heart. Heart is incompletely four chambered. When we just examine the previous class in the classification of chordata, the class which lies above reptilia is amphibia. In amphibians, there are three chambers in the heart. There will be right auricle, left auricle, and one ventricle. In the case of reptiles, there are two auricles and there is one ventricle, but this ventricle is partially divided. So that is why it is called incompletely four-chambered. This has got a partial septum, so it is incompletely four-chambered. But there is an exception among reptilia, that is these crocodiles, they are having a four-chambered heart. Then already we have discussed their respiration is purely pulmonary with the help of lungs. Coming to the ear, they have got middle ear and inner ear, but there is no external ear. They carry out internal fertilization, which is one of the features that enabled them a completely terrestrial life, because they do not require a water body for fertilization. Fertilization is internal, that is, the sperms are transferred from the body of the male into the body of the female, and fertilization takes place inside the female body, so there is no requirement of a water body for fertilization like amphibians or fishes. Now coming to their eggs. The eggs are heavily filled with yolk, which will nourish the developing young one. The eggs are cladoid. Cladoid means shelled. And this is one more feature which enables them a terrestrial life, because since the eggs are shelled and the embryo grows inside the egg, it will not lose water through dehydration or desiccation because it is protected by the shell. So cladoid egg is also a feature that enabled them a terrestrial mode of life. Now, the development is direct with no larval stage, and the embryo grows inside a bag which is filled with fluid. This bag is called as amnion, and it is filled with the fluid which is called as amniotic fluid. So the embryo grows inside the amniotic cavity. So from reptilia onwards, in all the higher classes you will meet with in further classification, that is after reptilia you have birds and mammals. From reptilia onwards, the organisms are successfully leading a completely terrestrial life. This is because of the presence of this particular membrane, which is called amnion, that forms a bag around the developing embryo. It provides the watery environment for the development of the embryo, so it need not resort to an external water body for completing its development. So from reptilia onwards, that is reptiles, birds and mammals. The classes are otherwise called as amniota. So reptiles, birds and mammals are amniotes because of the presence of amnion during development. Now, which are the living reptiles? Before going to the names of the classes, we will just get familiarized with the organisms coming under reptilia. Crocodiles and alligators, chelonts, which include turtle, tortoises, terrapins. Then you have snakes and lizards. And there is one particular group under reptilia, which includes only a single genus, that is Sphenodon. And it is considered to be a living fossil. It is still present, but it shows many primitive characteristics. And this is an organism which is found only in New Zealand. So this is also a member of reptilia. And we will get familiarized with some of the organisms through their pictures. You can see a green turtle. Then this is Geochelon elegans or star tortoise. Trionyx. Terrapins. This is a turtle. You can see the egg laying in turtles. The salt glands. Now the crocodiles. Gavials. Alligators. You can see the scales on the surface of these organisms, different types of modified scales. Then Hemidactylus, the flying lizard, marine reptile, chameleon, which shows camouflage, Calotus or the garden lizard, desert lizards, snakes, Naja, Daboya, poisonous snake, Bangaris, and this is Sphenodon, which we mentioned.